Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Protests continue in the US following fatal police shooting of Dante Wright. President Biden to withdraw all US troops from Afghanistan by September 11th. Egyptian journalist Khaled Dawood released from detention after 18 months. St. Vincent and the Grenadines witnesses fifth day of volcanic eruptions. Iran announces increase in uranium enrichment as Vienna talks set to resume. In our first story, we go to the US, which marked the third consecutive day of protests against the police killing of a black man. 20-year-old Dante Wright was fatally shot in his car on April 11th in Brooklyn Center. Police have claimed that his car had been pulled over because of a traffic violation. Officers then found out that he had an outstanding warrant. They have claimed that Wright attempted to escape custody and was then shot. However, activists have argued that the traffic violation was used as a pretextual stop, often used to target black people. Protests broke out on Sunday as hundreds gathered outside the Brooklyn Center Police Station. The building has now been surrounded by concrete blocks and a metal fence. The protests have been met with heavy repression from police forces and the National Guard. This includes the use of tear gas, rubber bullets, and flashbang grenades. A curfew was imposed in Brooklyn Center and surrounding areas on Tuesday evening from 10 p.m. till 6 a.m. Later in the night, the Hennepin County Sheriff's Office declared an unlawful assembly demanding that protesters disperse. As per local media reports, the Minnesota State Patrol announced around midnight that 60 people had been arrested. As reported by KIRO 7 News, around 40 people were also arrested on Monday. They are facing charges including rioting and violation of curfew. Police Chief Tim Gannon claimed that the police officer who shot Wright had mistaken her gun for a taser. Both Gannon and the officer in question, Kim Porter, resigned on April 13th. The charges against Porter are expected to be announced on Wednesday. Continuing with the US, the Biden administration has announced the withdrawal of remaining troops from Afghanistan. A government official announced on April 13th that all US troops will leave the country by September 11th, while the US had over 100,000 troops in Afghanistan in 2011, the official numbers have reduced to around 2,500. The withdrawal of troops was part of a deal signed between the Trump administration and the Taliban last February. The deal originally had May 1st as the deadline for the withdrawal. This had been conditional on Taliban's non-cooperation with Al-Qaeda and ISIS and national peace talks in Afghanistan. However, the Biden administration is now reportedly planning to withdraw troops without conditions. As reported by the Washington Post, officials have stated that the US will continue to provide aid and assistance to the Afghan government. The US reportedly also intends to be involved in the peace process between the government and the Taliban. While formal talks between the two have been ongoing since last September, no concrete agreement has been reached. A meeting between the two sides has also been scheduled between April and May in Turkey. Representatives from Qatar and the UN will also be present. However, the Taliban has not yet confirmed if it will be in attendance. According to a statement, the organization will not participate in any conference unless all foreign troops are withdrawn completely. Egyptian journalist and politician Khaled Dawood has been released from prison pending investigation. He was arrested in 2019 during the protests against President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi. Dawood ended up spending over 18 months in a Cairo prison after his pretrial detention was renewed multiple times. He was accused of collaborating with a terrorist organization, publishing fake information, and misusing social media, and according to local reports, he was released around midnight on April 12th. As reported by Middle East Eye, the Egyptian Press Club has stated that no charges have been brought against him. Dawood is the former head of the liberal Al-Dastur party. He was also a spokesperson for the National Salvation Front and the assistant editor-in-chief of Al-Ahram Weekly. Being a prominent opposition figure, he was also an open critic of the government's policies. He opposed military rule in Egypt and spoke out against human rights violations and the crackdown on dissenters. Rights groups have estimated that around 60,000 political prisoners are being held in Egypt. Following his arrest, Dawood had reportedly filed complaints regarding the poor living conditions in detention. He was banned from receiving personal belongings, including clothes. According to advocacy group Dawn, he was also barred from exercising outside his cell and reading newspapers. He was also unable to contact his son for almost a year following his arrest. St. Vincent and the Grenadines has witnessed multiple explosions from the La Soufriere volcano. The volcano has erupted 5 times since April 9th, covering the island in thick volcanic dust. Thick plumes of smoke and ash have also been reported. Prime Minister Ralph Gonsalves had first issued a stage 3 disaster alert on April 8th. Around 16,000 to 20,000 people have been evacuated so far. Scientists have also warned that explosions of a similar or greater magnitude could occur in the next few days. Government officials reported countrywide water shortages on April 13th. They announced that ash from the volcano had contaminated local water supplies. Authorities have been unable to harvest any water, leading to a 50% depletion of storage. The ash has also ruined crops, which is expected to affect food supplies. The toxic gases released during the eruptions also pose serious health risks for the country. UN Attorney General Antonio Guterres stated on April 12th that the entire population was without electricity. It was on the same day that humanitarian aid from Venezuela reached the island country. The government of Nicolas Maduro has sent 68 doctors, rescuers, and natural disaster experts. President Maduro has sent a ship carrying food, drinking water, mattresses, and health kits. The ship will be at the disposal of SVG during the emergency and will also be used to transport aid from other Caribbean countries. And in a final story, we go to Iran, which has announced that it will increase its uranium enrichment level to 60%. The enrichment process will take place at the Natanz facility. The nuclear site recently faced a blackout, which has been attributed to Israel. The decision was announced just as the talks around the 2015 nuclear deal are set to resume. All signatories to the deal had first met for a joint commission meeting in Vienna last week. US officials were also present, however, there were no direct official talks between US and Iran. Here is Prabir Purkayastha to talk about the current scenario and the way forward.
Iran's actions have been response to violations of the JCPOA by the Americans and the Europeans' inability to keep to any of the conditions they had agreed to in order to keep the deal alive, which is that we will maintain our relations, our financial deals with you, will be able to set up a separate payment gateway. All that they failed. And they failed because the United States really has a stranglehold on the banking system. And therefore, it's very difficult for Western companies to violate the banking sanctions that the US imposes, the financial sanctions. And it means operating any company outside the framework of the US banking system, as well as the financial system, which US really controls. So given that, the Europeans failed, and that is why the Iranians then said that they will have step-by-step then action they would take, which is also laid down in the agreement itself. It does appear that the United States is now doing what Obama had talked about, the move to switch to an Asian axis. So I think containment of China still remains the US major plan. But they have added Russia to it. Ukraine is again seeming to hot up. The Donbas region, what is going to happen, we don't know. So I don't think we are going to see a return to normalcy if there was ever one. So we have to take. So the issue really is, can Iran and Saudi Arabia sit down and talk about Yemen with their Yemeni allies, as well as the Yemeni forces, which are also there. If the Saudi allies, the Yemeni allies of Saudi Arabia, lose Marib, which they seem to be at the moment rather precariously placed, that opens a door to Saudi Arabia as well. And therefore, Saudi Arabia might be much more under pressure to negotiate a return to normalcy in Yemen. And if that happens, that makes the Iran-Saudi Arabia relationships then relatively less fraught with danger and warlike threats as they have been till now. So I think Saudi Arabia is also beginning to feel the heat of the Yemen war. It has been a very unpopular war. It has been continuing for the last 5-6 years. It has destroyed Yemen, but it has also taken its toll on Saudi Arabia. So given the fact that the Yemenis have shown that they can hit inside Saudi Arabia using basically missiles and so on, I think all of this makes Saudi Arabian position weaker. And maybe that they will welcome Chinese backdoor negotiations with Iran to see how the Yemen issue can also be sorted out, and there is a certain normalcy in Yemen that is restored, which was destroyed really by Saudi Arabia at one point of time.
Right.
So can that Yemen scenario be returned to a peaceful path? I think it's an important issue. But the important issue is that it is not NATO, it is not United States. This has to be done by actually Saudi Arabia and Iran themselves. And that, if that happens, I think that's a huge change for West Asia. And can the JCPOA process, what China has done, what Russians might be tacitly willing to do, maybe the biggest beneficiary will be a return to West Asia's regional politics reasserting itself and not being dictated by global politics and global power plays. And I think that would be a very important gain for the region and for peace in the region.
And that is all we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website, peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.